Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Nazara Technologies Limited Q2 FY 2022 earnings conference call hosted by Spark Capital Advisors India Private Limited. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal the operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Sundar from Spark Capital Advisors India Private Limited. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Lizanne. Good morning. First of all, I would like to wish festive greetings to one and all present in this call on behalf of Spark Capital. We are pleased to invite you all to the 2Q FY22 conference call of Nazara Technologies Limited. The company is represented today by Mr. Nitish Mitra Singh, Joint Managing Director, Mr. Manish Agrawal, Group CEO, and Mr. Rakesh Shah, Group CFO. Over to Mr. Nitish for opening remarks. Thank you.
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Nitish. We are not able to hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Good morning and a very welcome to all of you to Nazara Technologies Q2 and H1 FY22 earnings call. I hope you and your families are keeping safe and healthy. I have with me Manish Agarwal, our Group CEO, and Rakesh Shah, our Group CFO, and Strategic Growth Advisors, our IR firm. We have uploaded our results presentation on the exchanges and on our website, and I hope everyone has had an opportunity to go through the same. The results of the first half of FY22 demonstrate our company's strong operating performance on the back of our ability to transform and realize synergies from our acquired companies. Having already attained a leadership position in the Indian gaming industry, now Nazara is now strategically placed to take advantage of the encouraging trends that India is demonstrating in our core business and the opportunity of gaming for a billion plus users. Our growth prospects are fueled by macroeconomic factors, including smartphone penetration, low cost and fast data access, and the rapidly evolving digital payment infrastructure in our country. Thus, we believe that our businesses are poised for sustainable growth into the foreseeable future. With a view to building a network of skilled gaming destinations operating on one common tech platform, I am very pleased to welcome the OpenPlay team to the Friends of Nazara network. Our endeavor is to build India's largest vernacular social gaming and entertainment platform and further strengthen our position in the large opportunity presented in the skill gaming space. Today's youth demand an increasingly diverse and engaging experience as the lines between gaming, esports, comedy and music become blurred and gaming becomes more mainstream. With esports continuing to be a key segment for us, we have acquired the gaming and adjacent IP businesses of OML Entertainment. This acquisition will help us massify gaming and esports by tapping into emerging synergies in gaming entertainment that a 14 to 20 year old is looking for today. With these two acquisitions in the past quarter, as well as the PublishMe acquisition we announced in the earlier quarter, we believe that we are well placed to capitalize on exciting opportunities in the vertical we operate. Also, importantly, at the midpoint, as we are in the midpoint of the year, we have visibility for our FY22 revenues to grow in the range of 35% to 40% over FY21. And we expect our EBITDA margins for the entire year to come in at 13% to 15%. We will continue to pursue strategic investment and acquisition opportunities to expand our business offerings, leverage existing strategic partnerships to enhance capabilities and market positions, grow our user base, deepen market penetration, and expand products that we are offering into complementary categories and new markets, as well as increase stakes that we hold in existing investments and subsidiaries. I would like to thank all our customers, colleagues, and business partners, and our shareholders for the continued support that has allowed us to focus on long-term strategy in the interest of our company. We are on a great journey to build a substantial business, and I'm looking forward to our most exciting years ever ahead of us. I would like to conclude by wishing all of you a very happy Diwali and a festive week ahead to enjoy with your family, friends, and colleagues. Now I will hand over the call to Manish to walk you through the quarterly highlights. Manish, over to you.
Thanks, Nitish. Am I audible, Nitish?
Yes, sir, you're audible. Please go
audible.
Ahead.
All right. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Nazara's earnings call for the first half. And what Nitish has led an outstanding platform for me to kind of just give you some exciting news about our first half results. We delivered 260.8 crores of revenues, which is 30% growth year on year. We grew 700% year on year on EBITDA margins. EBITDA delivering a 49.6 crores of EBITDA. It's very heartening to see companies when they grow and revenue at faster clip, but also continue to improve their margins. And our margins have improved from 3% last year first half to 19% this year first half. That has translated into a very strong PAT, which has grown from 8.3 crores last year to 2.28 crores this year. And last year, if you remember, a lot of you had looked at our DRHP and said it's a loss-making company, and we made a loss of 8.3 crores of PAT, which was in our DRHP. We had mentioned to you that we have a very strong visibility of, we are a unit economics-driven company and very strong visibility of our EBITDA margins and PAT. So happy to kind of really share that 28 crores of PAT is what's delivered in the first half. These were the very salient modes. One of the important thing which we have always really kind of track is the cash flow generated. And we've generated close to 50 crores of net cash from the business operations in first half, which kind of really shows that we are not just growing, but we are a solid business, which is a cash generating business. And our ability to continue to drive consumer tailwinds, which we are seeing in this market, and convert them into revenue, EBITDA, PAT, and then cash flow is very visible in our business. And that's what we really kind of look for. I will very quickly run to segmental performances. Having done two earnings call, I understand that the Q&A is the best way to really clarify a lot of questions. So I will not take much time. Gamify learning segment led by IP Kidopia, which is catering to 2 to 7 year olds. It's a subscription app predominantly in North America, 90% of that business. It contributes to 41% of our revenues in first half. Our paid subscriber stand at 324,699. Some of you who had attended Q1 call were kind of worried about quarter on quarter decline in net new subscribers. I'm pleased to say that that decline has been stemmed, which was caused because of issues of Apple IDFA. And we have grown in quarter two or quarter one in a net new subscriber. And that's a positive trend and a movement which we are seeing, which will, which barring the minor blip which we had seen in quarter one, we have always been on a growing path in net new subscribers. Our revenue stood at 105.9 crores versus 78.7 crores over the same time period of first half to first half, which translates into a growth of 35%. Our EBITDA from this segment was 35.4 crores. Versus a loss of roughly 4 crores in the last year. This segment has a direct causality to our marketing spends and growth. There was a decline in marketing spend in quarter one, if you would have noticed, compared to quarter four. And quarter two, we have again found more marketing channels to really grow our marketing spend. And if you look at in quarter two, we had spent 2.6 million on marketing spend, which is 46% more than the quarter one spend. However, our first half spend is still lesser than the first half spend of last year by 35%, and which is where we are really working towards to continue to find more cost optimal unit economics driven marketing channels to drive units of net new subscriber growth aggressively. Our cost per trial because of experimentations in quarter two increased to 33 from an usual range of $26 to $28. And we are very conscious of about it. And we believe that in quarter three, we will be back to $28, $29. Our other operating parameters, I'm very happy to inform that trial to activation ratios or the monthly churn or the ARPUs, they are all the same. So the consumer engagement, consumer retention, consumer monetization continues to be very, very strong, which is the core of this app, which helps us to create a scalable, profitable business model. I'll move to the second segment, esports, which contributes to roughly 40% of the first half revenues. And if you look at this segment has been on a very strong growth path of 62% year on year, and it's posted 103 odd crores of revenues. Our EBITDA grew from this segment from rupees 7 crores to 14 crores, which is doubling of the EBITDA. Please note that our first half this year, FY22 numbers include 3.1 crores of revenue from PublishMe acquisition, which was consolidated for September month. And to that extent, the 3.1 crore is an additional and it's not apple to apple comparison. With PublishMe acquisition, we established capability and capacity to expand esports into Middle East. And that's what we are very excited about. And we are working between PublishMe and NodWin teams together. How do we really capitalize this opportunity which has opened up? So our belief and conviction on esports continues to be very strong. And we believe that this segment with very strong tailwinds will continue to grow and engage with millennials. And that 14 to 30 audience with the acquisition of the live business and adjacent IPs business of OML, we are very truly committed to massifying esports and bringing it to the main stage of the entertainment in this country. Within esports, as you always know, there are two companies and now PublishMe is the third one, but I'll kind of take you through NodWin. NodWin has grown 30% in first half to first half, reporting a revenue of 69 crores. Its EBITDA is up by 85% to 3.8 million, 3.8 crores. And if you look at our media rights business, continues to be the driver of this revenue segment. 61% of the revenue of NodWin came from media rights. Some notable things in this quarter, we have extended our partnership and deepened a partnership with Tencent in South Asian Championships, as well as we have launched Tencent PUBG Mobile Pro League, PUBG Mobile Club Open. And these are the IPs in which we are really working with Tencent very closely, and it has really become now a multi-year partnership. Our global expansion and amplification of international IP is working on very well. Umzanzi and Inoski in Africa and Valorant in South Asia are doing very well. I'm pleased to say that Umzanzi has broken even after 2 years, and that's what we have maintained, that it takes 2-3 years for our own IPs to really break even in investments. I'm also pleased to inform that our consumer business in NodWin, which we are calling now under retail, where we are selling e-pins for Steam and Valve, plus we also see an opportunity in future as more and more app stores allow third-party purchases. We see that mobile-based businesses can also become important, and we are really doubling down on our retail side of our business because we already have an existing community. And we are increasing our distribution channels in this quarter. We are increased from PhonePe, Snapdeal for Prince business. And we are looking at more opportunities to kind of grow the retail business on the bank of the strong community, which we have access to community, which we have in NodWin. Our second business, SportsKeeda, has really kind of been on a tearing growth. It grew 187% in revenue in first half to first half, delivering a 30.8 crores of revenues. Its EBITDA is also up by 134%, delivering 10.2 crores of EBITDA. And these are the kind of new age media businesses where when you have a non-linear growth in users, that really translates into EBITDA. And that's the beauty of new age media businesses built on top of tech and very strong consumer affinity. H1 EBITDA margin of 33%. We have invested heavily on content. We are investing heavily on building teams. And that is all investment into future, which is in spite of that, there's a 33% EBITDA. Our MAUs have grown 36%. We delivered 56 million of MAU as of September. There's a marginal decline quarter on quarter, just only because of the IPL being there in April versus no big sporting event being there in July, August, September. And in spite of that, the growth has been fantastic. And the growth is purely fueled by addition of new sports. Our adjacency theory to WWE sports is really working out. Our new edition of MMA is playing out very well on as a content on our site. The third segment, which I would like to kind of take you through, is premium. Premium business, the commentary hasn't changed. It is still in the same orbit business where the revenues grew by 10% in first half over last year first half. In-app revenues grew by 8%. If you look at quarter on quarter, there was a marginal decline in DAU and revenue, and it's because there was an IPL in April versus no IPL in quarter two. Our percentage conversion of users from playing to paying, which is the key metrics which we have always maintained, is still a range bound. There is no scale velocity we have attained on that, and the team is working. However, if you compare it to WCC2, which was the game, it's 0.01% versus WCC3, where it hovers around 0.08% to 0.15%. When there's a large sporting event, it shoots to 0.12 to 0.15, and there is no large sporting event, it comes down to 0.08 to 0.1%. And that's the trajectory which we have seen here, and hence we have still not found an LTV CAC equation to kind of really break the attain the escape velocity, and the work continues on that front. On the telco business, which is the another segment which we have declined by 19% first half to first half. There's a slight decline in EBITDA margin. This continues to be a cash cow for us. And as you would see, and we have maintained, the contribution from this segment will be keep coming down. It was 16.5% last year, now it's 13%. And we continue to see a decline in contribution from telco business going forward as well. The last segment is a skill-based real money gaming segment where, as Nitish mentioned, we welcome the Open Play team. We are really looking at building this segment in a very structured manner, in a very pragmatic manner. And as I interacted with many of you when we had acquired Open Play, our view is that this segment has very strong network effects. And for you to succeed and becoming big, you need to have a concurrency of users, concurrency, liquidity of money, as well as a trusted brand, and Open Play really is one step into it. We are going to really work out and create one common platform, which will first of all integrate HalaPlay, Open Play into one common tech platform and leverage that. And then going forward, we continue to look at building this segment through consolidation. As you would see, we really have an amazing flywheel which is going here, which really our current portfolio, there is a momentum in our current portfolio, there is M&A happening in the subsidiaries, as well as there's an M&A happening at the top. So what you could see is that that flywheel really now working very fast at the group level as well as at the subsidiary level, and we intend to really create a compounding effect of value creation at both levels. And we are relentlessly pursuing our original dream. And we believe that to endure over a long period of time in this fast and dynamic business, we need to be agile. We need to be really always looking at outside in. And that's where this complete strength of Nazara structure allows us the bandwidth to be able to do that. With that, I'd like to thank you for this opportunity for me to give this commentary. And we'd like to open this floor for Q&A. Before that, wishing you all a very happy Diwali and stay safe and enjoy with your families and friends. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin with the question and answer session. Anyone wishing to ask a question may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question key assembles. The first question is on the line of Nitin Jain from Fairview Investment Advisories. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good morning and thank you for the opportunity. So first of all, wishing you all a happy Diwali. So I have basically two questions. So firstly, on the Kiddopia business, Google has recently decreased the service fee for all subscription-based apps from 30% to 15% starting 1st of November. So what kind of a positive impact should it have on our Kiddopia business? And a related question on Kiddopia is, where are we on the Europe expansion plan? My next question is on freemium. So we have seen, like there was a news report sometime back where, so there was integration of AxeDeal with the WCC3 app. So where do we see this foray going? Like, should we see more aggression here going forward? Thank you.
Right. Thanks. Let me kind of answer that. On the Google Play reducing its commission from 30 to 15, it's indeed a positive move for all publishers, including Kiddopia, because it really kind of saves that 15% of the commission which you pay on subscription. However, our Google contribution is much smaller because it's Kiddopia is predominantly North America, dominated by iOS, and our revenues are very, very dominated by App Store. So there will be some effect, but it will be very, very, very small given the Google is 10% of the overall portfolio or 15%. That's the max portfolio. So yes, it's a positive thing. And what I think, but the macro is more important here. With the large App Store app destinations going for a reduction in the commission for the publishers stroke developers, is a very, very welcome move. And this will kind of set precedent for others to follow.
Okay, and on the Europe expansion plan?
And on the Europe expansion bit, we have looked at, our view is that US is the primary market, given that we need to really double down on finding optimal channels for marketing growth. We are really focusing on US and US growth, rather than really looking at a fragmented Europe market where we have to do a lot of hard work on multiple languages, both in terms of content on app as well as in marketing. So we have not really doubled down on increasing our languages beyond Germany into French or Spanish or any other language. And we are solidly focused on how to get the accelerated net new subscriber growth in US.
Okay, so shall we read this as the company has shared the plan for Europe, or is it just
deprioritized would be better?
Okay, and on the freemium integration.
On the freemium thing, these are the brand partnerships. I would not read much into it. These brand partnerships are important to kind of really. It's a constant endeavor from our side to keep bringing gaming into a mainstream of advertising and partnership with large FMCG companies and other consumer-facing companies. But I would not read much into it, because for this to become a meaningful, a large revenue and a very strong tangibility and predictability kind of a business, I still don't see this.
Okay, thank you. I'll join the queue for follow-up questions.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants in this conference, we request you to limit your questions to two per participant only. The next question is on the line of Jinesh Joshi from Prabhudas Lilladher. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. Sir, in this quarter, our cost per trial was 33, and we expect it to revert back to 26 to 29. So does this imply a rollback in the Apple's policy, or is the marketing cost in other channels expected to fall? And if it's latter, can you highlight any specific reason behind it?
No, so absolutely. I think its answer is very simple here. Earlier, if you remember, in our interaction, I said that we spend 60% in Google, then 30% roughly in Apple, and 10% in Facebook. Those were the three standard channels fully optimized, and where we were able to see from click to the trial to activation ratio completely. However, when we were looking at new channels, whether it's Unity or whether it's programmatic or whether it's Iron Source and any other network, initial days you always would appreciate that you will need to experiment to figure out where is the cost, how is the cost of bidding for that keyword, how does that advertising channel really works. And that's the experimentation which we were doing in this quarter to expand our reach from those three channels to more channels so that we can spend and attract more users to trial while the attribution issue of Google is getting sorted. So to that extent, your cost per trial is increased and it's only on account of experimentation in other channels. Now, as we will find some steady state, we are looking forward to bringing the cost down to 29, 30 max, not more than that, cost per trial dollars.
Okay, sir. And this is similar to this reduction in the Google's Play Store commission. I think one ruling also came out in the US that Apple can no longer force the iOS users to keep paying through their own payment gateways. And considering that majority of our subscribers for Kiddopia are in North America, do we expect a reduction in the commission cost to come down from about 28 or 30% to significantly lower level?
Two parts of that answer. One, one needs to experiment on the friction that when you have a third party payment really being received, how will the user's friction will be there? And that we can only see once we implement. And when can we implement? Once Apple has really rolled it out. The court, the ruling which you referred to, had given them 90 days, and I think that a subsequent matter has gone into some appeal. So Apple has still not rolled out, and since it has not rolled out, we have not really experimented on what is the benefit, on how much of the benefit will actually accrue to us. And given that situation, at this juncture, it will be difficult to say how much a positive it will be. But in a directional sense, it should be positive for Kiddopia as well as for every other publisher.
So one last question. I think OpenPlay's fair share of revenue comes from South India, and with Karnataka banning online games, do you think that we'll be able to sustain this 80 crores kind of an annualized run rate going ahead?
So in the skill-based real money gaming business, there have been a fair share of positive and negative, and more positive than negative. Like Tamil Nadu opened up, Kerala opened up, and Karnataka got closed. So that's the short summary, that you have got two states, and Tamil Nadu is a large state from a contribution point of view compared to Karnataka. So you will see a much larger, your ability to spend money to attract more users will be there. And hence, Karnataka is definitely a 12-13% contribution, which we will lose. But Tamil Nadu was closed and it got opened, I think, towards the fag end of the quarter. And that will really come into play in the second half. So I think this is kind of a portfolio where you have to look at net sum rather than individually.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Dipesh from Equirus. Please go ahead.
Yeah, sir. Good morning, and thanks for taking my questions. Sir, just wanted some clarity on the 35-40% the revenue guidance that you have given. So can you just break it up? What's your revenue expectation on the OML and the OpenPlay acquisitions? And what's your organic growth assumption for the year?
So OML acquisition, if you look at it, it is purely from your IPs which you've acquired and some of the other adjacent businesses. I would not at this juncture give you a very specific OML number. Don't want to kind of get into that. But if you look at if you want to understand the revenue numbers minus OML versus this, is that what you're really trying to understand, Deepesh?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
So I think that kind of a second level of guidance and detailing, we need to really look at it. We are not open to giving that.
Got it. Sir, but OML, I think FY20 was 91 crores and FY21 was like very low at 28 crores. So in FY22, do you think it is growing or it is the same level as FY21? That's what I want.
I think
So look at the business impact came from the offline businesses predominantly, that 48 versus 91, and that COVID offline events have still not happened and not happening this year. So I don't see that revenue build up and bump up to come in this financial year, and they would be in the same vicinity for this year also, what they did last year.
Okay, got it.
And, our consolidation will only be for the 6 months.
Got it. So secondly, in the sir, gamified learning segment, can you please share the gross new subscriber addition that you have seen in the first half? And also the cost per trial has increased, right? So $33, you're saying it will come down to $26.29, which is still higher than $22, which you were seeing last year. So any plans, or have you already taken a price hike for your customers?
So we took a price hike in June, if you remember, right? From yes. $7 to $8. I think that's a price hike we will stick to it for the time being. And we are not looking at any other price hike. $22 cost per trial, I don't think those days are going to come back. The new norm will be anywhere between 26 to 29 is what it will continue to be in terms of cost per trial.
As of the gross new subscriber addition, that number can you share?
Gross subscriber addition, Dipesh, I don't have handy, because we look at the net gross minus churn, because that's the real number to track.
Got it. And lastly, sir, any reason why the NODWIN number actually declined quarter on quarter? Like, is there any seasonality, if you can talk about it, sir?
NODWIN numbers, if you look at it, is purely a function of your events and seasonality, right? And which is where the NODWIN, or broadly any kind of an esports, which is driven by your marquee events of IPL, and the NODWIN is very dependent on when the large championships are happening, or white level championships are happening. So that is the reason why you would look at a quarter on quarter. But if you look at it from a yearly basis, it will be in a very high growth. Plus, if you see the first half itself, it is 30% growth.
Yeah. Got it, sir. That's all my answer. Happy Diwali to you and everybody. Thank you.
Thank you. Same to you.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Shyam Sundar Sriram from Sundaram Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Hi, sir. Good morning. Thanks for taking the question. So my question is again on NODWIN, just continuing from the prior question, sir. So you did say that, you know, there is a seasonality depending on when events happen. So you mean to say when there are other high profile events like IPL, the NODWIN, the events that happen that will be sort of on a muted note, and therefore when there are no such high-profile events, this will be revert to high-growth phase?
No, Shyam. Let me just clarify. Esports segment has two parts. I might have been very clear, because Dipesh was very familiar with the business. So one is the seasonality of the NODWIN events on its own, which they do as their own IP or their white label with the publisher. That shifting from one quarter to another quarter is something which could happen, but that's where you need to look at year on year what kind of growth they are looking at. That the comment regarding marquee sporting events like IPL was more in conjunction with SportsKeeda rather than NODWIN.
Okay. And so when we think of NODWIN, sir, so should we think a steady growth rate of, say, 25 to 30% on an annual basis? Is that something still possible, or are there any headwinds there?
So, Shyam, if you look at it, they grew 30% first half over first half, right?
Okay.
And we are saying that if you look at from a NODWIN perspective, their first half is roughly around 35 to 39% of the overall year revenue.
Correct.
If you look at historically, the second half is far more stronger because of more events, better climate, weather in India, and non-exam facilities, brands, all of those factors. So second half is always stronger than the first half or not. So to answer your question, having a growth of 30% is absolutely doable. Then the first half itself is 30%, and second half being more stronger than the first half.
Understood, sir. Thank you very much. Sir, and just one question on this open play. I mean, you did comment about an 80 crore kind of a run rate there. How to think of growth in this segment, sir? Because this is a slightly newer segment. So relative to, say, for example, a NODWIN, while these are different segments per se, but if you were to compare this with NODWIN, How will the growth be here relative to Nodwin, for example? Is it a much higher growth segment than Nodwin, or if you can share your thoughts on the growth in this segment?
So if you look at the segment in which OpenPlay is operating, it's a very large market already established. And OpenPlay is a small player which is trying to gain share in a fairly mature market, right? Versus Nodwin, which is the market leader in a very nascent category. I think that that's a fundamental difference between the nature of the segments which they're operating, both in terms of evolution of that segment as well as the relative position of respective company. Now, for Nodwin, the task is to build the market and continues to grow. For OpenPlay, the task is to gain share. And gain share at a unit economics level rather than go kind of a mindless spend. So from an OpenPlay perspective, we would like to really have a growth number of 30% year on year, which we can deliver, keeping the unit economics in mind, is something we should be very happy about. And anything more than that would be a pleasant surprise for us. For Nodwin, we said that we have to continuously keep building the market and growing the market. Our endeavor is to find new partnerships, whether with publishers, brands, platforms, and keep growing this, because we believe the tailwinds are very strong and the market is very small today, and we can shape it.
Understood, sir. Now, thank you very much. I'll fall back in the queue. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on to the next question. That is from the line of Saugat Chatterjee from BNP Paribas Mutual Fund. Please go ahead.
Hi, team. Just one question from my end. So in terms of this content cost, we've seen that the content cost has fallen on a quarter-on-quarter basis. So like any reason for that with regards to the content event and the web server cost?
You're looking at quarter one versus quarter two. Is that what you're looking at?
Right. Yeah.
Right. So if you look at the content cost, it's predominantly again related to your events and event thing in Nodwin, because the biggest delta of roughly 8 crores is coming from Nodwin in quarter one versus quarter two. So 21 crores was quarter one spend versus 16.5 overall, in which if you would see 8.1 crore reduction is coming from Nodwin itself, which is what just in continuation with the previous answer, why Nodwin has declined quarter on quarter. It is just the, when you have a big event happening, you have a revenue and associated cost along with it.
Right. Okay. And just one more question on the ad side. So in terms of Kidopia, what the earlier stated metric was that close to $1 to $1.2 million per month of marketing spend we used to do in the Kidopia business. So now with the change in Apple policy, could you give us number in terms of what kind of number we'll be looking to spend per month on the marketing side for the Kidopia business?
So, Shogat, number hasn't changed. That goalpost is not moving. Our ability to spend that, keeping the guardrails of unit economics, is what we are working. So, we understand from mathematically that we need to spend $1.2 million per month to ensure that we grow 3, 4, 5% of net new subscriber month on month. Now, our ability to spend that, keeping the cost per trials and our monthly number of months break even, those two elements in place, is what we need to figure out how to spend it. So that's why if you see average, we've spent 0.8 million per month in this quarter, 0.85 something, versus last quarter, which was even lesser. So we are trying to figure out how to spend money, but that number hasn't changed.
Okay. That's all from mine. Thank you, and wish you and the team a happy Diwali. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Sonal Minhas from Present Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, this is Sonal Minhas. Hi, Manish. Hi, everyone. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, hi. Good to hear you.
Hi, okay, cool. So I had two questions. First one was, I think two calls back when we started these earnings call, the growth guidance was always given in conjunction with the margins that you are targeting, because the two levers actually work in tandem. So given we've tapered on growth considering last year versus the year before, I just wanted to understand that if the 30% YOY guidance we're giving, are we planning to hold on to the current EBITDA margins because the marketing burn has gone down? That's one. And underlying, is there a reset we should look at in terms of your EBITDA margins guidance going further? That's the first one, Manish. I'll pause and let you answer.
So, Sonal, if you look at Nitish's opening commentary, he has given a 13 to 15% overall EBITDA margin guidance for this financial year, which is much higher than the numbers which we've always maintained that 6 to 8% is what we like to do and plow that back into revenue growth. Now, if you were to kind of unpeel that margin, it's predominantly coming from your Kiddopia gamified learning, high increase in margins. And those margins are increasing because what Shogat was also asking, that does the monthly spend number change? No, the desire to spend more does not change. It's an ability to spend is what is not happening. And hence, it's translating into higher EBITDA margins, which is where our overall EBITDA margin guidance is 13 to 15%. And that's what you should look at for this year, because we are looking at how to, with keeping within the unit economics, how to spend more money, and which will really kind of couple of quarters, we see that 1 million, 1.2 million number we will like to come back to per month.
I understand that. And on Kiddopia in particular, like the underlying operating matrices which you track, fundamentally the number of hours kids are spending on the app or the retention matrices, they look as is what they were maybe a year back or whenever you
absolutely. So all the metrics from trial to activation, number of time spent per day, number of days in a month, your retention cohort, your engagement numbers, nothing has changed. Your churn numbers, your ARPU. So yeah, all the consumer metrics are exactly the same. It's the key thing is how do we get more people to trial at the 26-28 range of cost per trial.
Got it. And as we enter the real money gaming business with the acquisition, Manish, just wanted to understand that it's again in that high burn category because you're establishing, consolidating. So just like Kiddopia here, what would be the ideology that you maybe 1 year, for 1 year, we're not focusing on it being unit economics positive, net of marketing positive, or there is a different ideology we are following for ramping up this vertical?
So Sonal, our ideology is that in a skill-based real money gaming business, we are not really going to burn money on the EBITDA level because if you go on that path, you will go down to invest substantial monies in building player concurrency and liquidity. We do not wish to do that through a massive amount of marketing spends, whether on brand or performance. For Classic and Open Play, it's a 20% EBITDA margin company. Will continue to grow. It's a very strong return on advertising spend in terms of months. And we will figure out how to continue to grow that. However, our largest strategy, as I mentioned during Open Play, is to build that concurrency and liquidity through consolidation in the market so that you are really playing from the position of strength rather than look at investing substantial amount of money into business and looking at over 2 years achieving that, which means that the cost of opportunity is very high. And we are not intending to do that.
Got it. Okay. So there is no loss cost there, basically, over time.
Correct. Yeah.
Got it. If I could just squeeze in maybe a question, Manish, just wanted to understand maybe from a 6 year, 1 year perspective, like maybe one or two challenges in the portfolio, which are your top priority as a CEO of the business, which you are like spending an inordinate time in the company, in the portfolio. Just want to, I think, munch upon that with you. Just want to understand that.
So, no, there are two things which we need to do it. One, at the operating level, let's say the key thing is how do we really go back to aggressive growth of net new subscribers of Kiddopia through more channels of marketing and optimize. That's the operating team is really spending considerable amounts of time on that. At the group level, we are looking at how do we fill in the white spaces, which we have in our portfolio in terms of across segments, whether gamified or freemium or esports or real money. And how do we ensure that each one of them is very strong growth as a segment we can report in terms of scale, growth, and right unit economics. So that's what we are really focused on driving at the corporate level. While in the operating team, that's one thing. Second thing is the premium, where we have to find a way to break this, find the scale velocity, because that's a huge opportunity for us to grow, but with the right unit economics in place.
So are you willing to like drop one of these juggling balls because there are too many in the air? Just curious, or this is not the time to answer that?
No. Sorry, I didn't get your question. Can you repeat, please?
No, I'm saying there are four or five verticals that are growing and have their own challenges. At a point in time, there is only so much that a team or management can juggle with. So are you like at a stage where you say that, listen, this business is not working out, or its unit economics is not what it is, and we're going to focus on three at a point in time, and that's enough to keep ourselves busy?
So the beauty of our structure is that there are amazing set of founders and leaders which are working on solving the operating problems, right?
Okay.
So let's say I am not personally going and sitting and designing the game for to improve in Aperture. There is a very strong team, capable team, which is working at it. Similarly, in Fidopia, there is a team which is working on how to drive that. So you are absolutely right. Focus is what is needed to solve one particular problem if you've done it. And that's where the Friends of Nazara structure really comes in handy, because it creates enough bandwidth in the group to achieve focus as well as continue to expand.
I get it. I think my point was more from capital allocation.
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Minas.
Yeah. I'll pause it.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mohan Kumar from MK Financial. Please go ahead.
Good morning, sir, and congrats on a decent set of numbers. So my first question is with respect to the revenue guidance. You have guided for 35-40% growth over the next for this fiscal year, which implies a sequential growth of 50% for the next quarter, or on average for the next 2 quarters. Am I thinking on the right line on that front, given that, you know, the last 2 quarters of last year was also really strong? I just want to understand if there is such a strong seasonality involved in the business for the second half to be significantly much stronger than the first half.
More mathematically, you're right. Because if you are kind of giving a 35-40% growth guidance, first half numbers are in front of basis clear, so yes, the math is right. Now, really understanding where is the math coming from? The math is coming from A, the seasonality in our business of NODWIN, which is, as I mentioned to you, is almost 35-39% first half, balance being second half. Plus, you have very strong cricket in Q3, which will have a direct causality, positive causality to premium as well as sports gear. So that's your current portfolio. And the Kidopia, you have holiday season, October, November, summer really coming in US. So there is always that seasonality which is there. And on top of it, you will have the consolidation really kind of playing out of publishing, open play, and the businesses of OML, which we really acquired. Combination of the current portfolio tailwinds, which are always there, and the consolidation which will play out, you will see that number.
Got it. Thank you. And could you just throw some light on the expected growth rate in the esports category in the coming 2 quarters? Because I do understand that the fourth quarter is not as strong for esports, given you had alluded to exams and things on those lines in the fourth quarter. So is most of the growth in esports likely to come in the next quarter?
Not really. If you look at obviously the third quarter is going to be much bigger than the fourth quarter, right? But if you would see the business, it's not that the fourth quarter is going to be significantly smaller. Yeah.
Got it. Thank you. And just one
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Kumar. May we request that you return to the question queue? Thank you. The next question is on the line of Deep Shah from BNK Securities. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for the opportunity. One question from my side. Sir, given the importance of strategic acquisitions, can you elaborate on the process we take to zero in on an investee? Like, how do you decide which company to invest in when? What is the typical process around it? Thank you.
Happy to answer that. I think it's a very simple for us. We have identified the demographics, we have identified the segments, and we have identified the white spaces. Given that these three things are absolutely part of our strategy, then we kind of really go out and look at for the right set of founders, because that's really where our key process starts. We are always looking for, and we don't just call it friends on the Zara network for the sake of it. We are really looking at people with whom we can be friends with, we can really work together, and who share the common DNA, common value system, and want to build to last and then build to exist. So this is exactly where looking at the three aspects: founders, the company scale of revenues. We are not looking at risk capital investment. We are looking at growth capital investment. And then the third piece is, what is the underlying business drivers, growth drivers, margin drivers, which we can identify, we can work, and we can really see tangibility of that in next 6 to 9 months, 12 months, rather than everything being in future. So that's how we really go about this whole process. Process has 3-4 steps, scouting of it, then doing a preliminary analysis of business data, financial data, spending considerable amount of time with founders and teams. That takes the longest time. And once we are then clear, then it's the execution. That's the process which we do.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on to the next question. That is on the line of Ishpreet from Motilal Oswal AMC. Please go ahead.
Hi, good morning, Manish. I just wanted to check. Yeah. So on the Sportskeeda part of it, so our margins have been quite soft on that. So going forward, what is it that we should assume and the reason for the lower margins?
Ishpreet, our investment on content will keep increasing in Sportskeeda, because that's the predominantly nature of that business. If you remember, I mentioned to you that having 45-48% EBITDA margins is not something which we desire or sustainable. As we add more sports categories, we build more sports content on and experiment with video content, we will continue to invest, because that is a very strong growth lever which we have seen manifesting into MAUs, manifesting into time spent, getting more loyal users, as well as helping us to drive more revenues. So we will continue to really do that. There is obviously a lag effect on when you include a new sports. It takes time to build that scale. It takes time to build that kind of a critical mass for advertisers to come in, and which is where it's a stated strategy, and we'll continue to do that.
Sure. Kidopia side of it, we are still lower than the March 21 numbers, right? So on an exit basis, any internal assumptions as to could we see kind of a double-digit growth, which is, if it's a possibility?
I think I would not be able to answer that question today, because how do we really look at our marketing spend growing, as I mentioned to other people who had asked, is something we are still looking at it. And with certainty, if I'm able to tell you that I'll be able to spend $1 to $1.2 million a month, then I would have been able to answer that question with complete certainty.
Okay, sure. Great. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Karan Uppal from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. Hi, Manish. So first question is on Kidopia. So you mentioned that you are still experimenting with the marketing channels. So has it settled? And for H2, can we expect better sub addition over H1? Any color would be helpful. And secondly, on Nodwin, so can you give us the pipeline of the esports events you are planning for H2? events like Mountain Dew Arena are back, or they are still not planned for it?
So Karan, on the Kiddopia piece, if you look at marketing spends in H2 versus H1, they will definitely be higher because our quarter one spends were lower. Quarter two is 46% more than quarter one. And we are constantly working on adding more channels, as well as we hope that large platforms like Google would be able to really come back and start firing for us. We are early stage partners for Google in their ability to go back to the normal of pre-IDFA, and we hope that should get solved. So H2 will definitely be more marketing spent than H1. So there is no doubt about that. And that should lead to more net new subscriber growth happening there. How much of that is a question mark? Would be able to kind of really go back to a 5% month-on-month growth, which is what we have desired, and we had looked at a sweet spot of spends and margins. That is something right, which I cannot tell you with certainty today. On the NODWIN piece, if you look at it, we have a full Tencent PUBG championships and other more championships line. I will request IR firm to kind of put that on site so that everybody can look at the second half of calendar, and so that you can get more details on that. And you'd ask something else.
I was asking about Mountain Dew Arena. All those events, like offline events, are also there in the pipeline?
No, I've offline still. No, it's still a no in offline. I don't think we are, at least in quarter three, we have not planned any offline. We are in a wait and watch phase on quarter four.
Right. Okay. And my last question is on the mix between Sportskeeda and NODWIN. So Sportskeeda revenue contribution is increasing. Right now it is at 32%. And it's obviously at a high margin than the NODWIN piece. So any target mix you have in mind for the overall esports business for the full year or maybe next year?
No, Karan, we are not looking at it like that. We believe that both these businesses have a very, very strong growth opportunity, and they will continue to grow very fast. And as I mentioned, I think to some Sonal or Mohan, the 35-39% is the first half contribution of NODWIN versus second half. And you would see that that growth both in Sportskeeda and NODWIN happening at a fast clip.
Thanks a lot, and wish you very happy Diwali.
Thanks, Karan. Wish you the same.
Thank you. The next question is in the line of Rahul Jain from Dolat Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi. Thanks for the opportunity. I have a couple of questions. Firstly, have our growth assumptions for Kiddopia revised down for FY22 or anything near-term basis versus what we used to think earlier? And also, I guess you have shared your view, but if you could tell us a little bit more in terms of your strategy in the RMG segment, do we stick to cash-neutral priority basis growth, or is there some incremental thoughts on that?
So Rahul, when we spoke on the RMG piece, and I'll just take that very quickly, our view is that we are not going to be making EBITDA losses, and we will grow within that thing, the open play classic Rummy business. For the larger segment, as I mentioned to you before and in on this call also, how do we really play out the whole consolidation in this space and continue to acquire scale of users for concurrency and liquidity? That is something we will work upon. But as far as the classic open play or Hala play is concerned, we will merge them into one network and we will drive them in a better positive manner.
And on Kiddopia?
On Kiddopia, the guidance for the year, as you could see that the first half as is in front of you, second half we are still kind of really looking at how do we increase the marketing spends. So from our perspective, if you look at the number, the growth number, is something we are still not able to predict with certainty on what number is going to be really pan out, because our ability to spend, it's a positive cash flow business. There is cash in the business. Our ability to accelerate the marketing spends, we have seen in past that we can do it very fast once we find that sweet spot. So the things can change and evolve
and that's why I'm a bit reluctant to kind of give you a guidance on that.
Right, and just lastly,
Mr. Jay, may we request that you return to the question queue? There are participants waiting for their turn.
Sure.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Prateek Kumar from Antique Stock Broking. Please go ahead.
Hello, yeah. Hi, good morning, sir. My first question is on NODWIN segment. So the proportion of media rights was at 61% this quarter in terms of revenues versus around 50% quarter on quarter, and I think 70-80% last year. How should this pan out like for the remaining part of the year and next year?
So Prateek, again, looking at NODWIN business from a quarter is will give you the wrong conclusions, because a big IP gets shifted from one quarter to another quarter will change the relative mix of revenue coming from media versus white label versus own IPs, right? And if you see that somebody had asked the quarter on quarter of NODWIN, you would see that your revenues are going to be second half versus this quarter, and which is where in absence of a large event, you will have a media rights contribution being shown at 61% versus 50%. I think a broadly safe territory is anywhere between 45 to 55% is a safe territory for your assumption, your modeling purposes for the media rights contribution for this year. As we continue to build more IPs, larger events, more white label things, we will continue to see that contribution, how it shapes in going forward. We will figure it out.
Thanks. And just one question. I mean, now we have like 8 months of listing and specific 2 quarters of earnings reporting and con calls. So is there any specific things that have changed like prior to listing, or how do you see benefit of listing generally coming across, if at all, in your business?
I think the biggest thing which for us, if you kind of take a step back, why did we wanted to go IPO was we wanted to really create a liquid stock to drive our M&A strategy, both in terms of increasing equity stake in our current portfolio, as well as attracting new founders, stroke their investors onto Nazara's strengths of Nazara Network. I think that is the key thing for us to do it, because if you remember, we didn't raise primary, we are cash positive and all of that. That's something is we are looking at, and that is playing out. If you look at our open play acquisition, we financed it through a liquid stock. And we are very happy to always demonstrate that anyone which really comes and joins Nazara's friends has always been benefited from the money which they thought they're going to make versus what they actually made in terms of stock price. And that really is a very strong case study for us to continue to go and talk to more founders and more investors. And I think that's something that directionally is becoming better and easier for us to have those conversations.
Thank you. I'll get back to you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, that was our last question. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Sundar for his closing comments.
Thank you all for participating. Hand it over to Manish for any closing comments. Thank you.
Nitish, you mean Sundar?
Nitish, please. Sorry.
Yeah. Thank you, everyone, for all your questions and for your time today. We look forward to being in touch, and wish you again a very happy Diwali. Thank you very much.
Then you can close the call.
Ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of Spark Capital Advisors, that concludes this conference call. We thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.